one too.
And finally ended up as president of KTH. So I have studied some physics, but I don't know very much about black holes. What I know more about is black holes in economy. We unfortunately don't have so many of those. We have, of course, some of them, but that's another story. We have, as a university, a motto which we think is very nice. We have from the beginning. It's called science and art. So we are both science and art, and mainly engineering art, but also art in itself. I think this conference is for science, but perhaps also a bit of art. There are beautiful theories and beautiful equations in this area, so I think it's a bit of art as well. By that, I will leave the word to my colleague, Astrid Söderberg-Widding, who is the Vice Chancellor of Stockholm University.
Thank you. Today, it's a great honor and a true pleasure for me as Vice Chancellor of Stockholm University, which is also co-hosting Nordita together with KTH, to join with my colleague, President Gudmundsson, in welcoming all of you, and in particular, of course, Professor Stephen Hawking. We are extremely pleased and proud to host this conference and that so many distinguished scholars have came here to take part in this historical Hawking Radiation Conference. Stockholm University has a strong research tradition in general theory of relativity and black holes, and it is therefore also scientifically very exciting for us to take part in this conference. We are extremely grateful to the University of North Carolina, and it's also a particular pleasure to welcome Chancellor Fault, and also to her team, of course, Laura Mersini Horton, for all efforts in co-arranging this together with Nordita and its director, Katie Fries. And I am convinced that we are all looking forward to intense, exciting, and rewarding scholarly exchanges during these days to come. Thank you.
Thank you. I too want to extend my greetings. We are so honored and excited to be here. I have a number of colleagues with me from UNC Chapel Hill, and it's just such a privilege to be here. I want to say how wonderful we've been treated already, and to come into this beautiful room, which was designed perfectly to facilitate the amazing conversations that are going to take place in the coming week. It's just really a fantastic tradition. At UNC Chapel Hill, which is in North Carolina, is a comprehensive university. Some of you may have visited. It has 14 schools. It's maybe not old by European standards, but it is the first public university in America, graduating its first students in the 1700s. Big research in lots of areas. We're very proud of our traditions in physics as well, going back in many different areas. In particular, one of the first faculty homes of Professor John Wheeler, who was, of course, the person who popularized the term black hole. I'm a biologist, so much of this for me is just in the popular fields. I think what's been exciting about this is having a chance yesterday to also go to the Nobel Museum and reading some of the quotes. I was really taken by Eugene O'Neill, and quote that said, "Happiness is for the timid, and scientists are not timid." So this is a place where they come to have debate, and I think we're going to be debating a 40-year-old puzzle, as Professor Hawking called it. And I want to say special thanks to my colleague, Dr. Laura Mersini Houghton, who is one of the people who really organized this. She described that she was having telephone conversations with many people about these great debates. And in a world of e-communication and Facebook, everybody said, what are we doing this online for? Let's get together face-to-face and have a conversation. So Facebook to FaceTime, I think it's great that you're having this conversation today. So we're so glad to be here. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Katie Fries, director of Nordita. Before I do anything else, young people, move up. I'm not saying another word until you do. No, not just an inch. I mean 10 feet. Come on. The people in the back, there are people stuck behind the door. It's in the fault of those of you in front, so come on.
I'll just feel this. Yeah.
Okay, there we go. That's better. Well, welcome, everybody. I wanted to say a few words about Nordita. So I came from Michigan to Stockholm because Nordita is one of the most wonderful, prestigious international institutes for theoretical physics in the world. And it was founded in 1957, a rather interesting situation. CERN, the Center for Research Nucléaire, which Copenhagen was competing for it. Well, they lost. It went to Geneva. So Niels Bohr decided to create an institute in Copenhagen in 1957, and it was illustrious from the beginning. Very many famous people there, many Nobel Prize winners working there for a long, long time. So this is now a 60-year-old place, which in 2007 moved here to Stockholm, hosted by the two universities, and you've heard from the leaders of these two universities. So we have, just so you know, we have in-house 4 faculty members, up to 20 Nordita fellows who all get jobs afterwards as postdocs, and then go on to faculty positions elsewhere. And so it's a great place. We're very happy to have everybody here for this wonderful conference, and very grateful, particularly to Laura, for getting this going. So welcome, and I'll pass it on to you.
Thank you. Thanks, Katie.
You are all here.
Thank you for coming. I am extremely pleased, honored, and humbled that we have 3 chancellors here, and the provost and the dean. Some flew halfway across the world to be here today, and especially recently, partially because of economic crisis that the world has been going through, the emphasis has gradually been shifting away from science and from universities as first and foremost temples of knowledge. So the fact that we have these chancellors here to honor us and welcome us in this conference shows that these universities really put it as their goal and center of attention, the very mission of being a temple of knowledge and discoveries. Otherwise, no pressure. So we have to come up with something this week. There is a story maybe many of you have heard with Faraday. The Minister of Finance visited him when he was working on electricity. And at the end he said, this is all very impressive, it sounds fascinating, most of it is above my head, but what is it good for? And Faraday's answer was, well, I don't know, sir, but I'm sure you'll tax it one day. So that's another aspect of knowledge, that although the discoveries and breakthroughs, their implications are not immediately obvious, but of course, this is the century of technology and science, and everything around us is based on those discoveries and development. I'd like to say a word about a friend and a colleague, Jacob Bekenstein. He was invited here, and he would have come, and he didn't. He died last week. It was sudden, it was a heart attack. He wrote a month ago saying he couldn't. He's the founding father of black hole thermodynamics, and he's very sad for us that he's not here. And we'll start now. Thank you for coming. Thank you.
Hello, welcome to the conferencing system. Please enter the security PIN for this conference. I'll connect you to your conference now.
I see. So it's not that they don't want to listen to Hooft.
This is supposed to be a historic meeting. I don't know whether I can do anything about that, but Hawking Foundation has been with us, indeed, as I said, for many years. And we have been confronted with theories so many times of people who said, now we understand everything. And my answer always has been, no, we don't. We don't understand everything about Hawking radiation. There are very many very fundamental problems with it.
This resonates a bit. Does it?
Can you hear me well? Okay. I would like to explain in what sense there are still mysteries about it. Basically, what you want to know is to understand the behavior of a black hole in terms of the behavior of things happening locally in its near or in its horizon or its environment. We understand the basic properties of the vacuum state, or so we thought, and the question is how to translate that into basic properties of a black hole. What is the black hole's Schrödinger equation? And questions like this. And the thing that's been disturbing me a lot was that you really don't understand how to do this particular translation, how to get the black hole properties, quantum properties, as precisely as the properties of a hydrogen atom, but now derived from properties of the vacuum and the fluctuations in and around that vacuum. So this is the problem. And now, being at this meeting, of course, the first subject that came to my mind to talk about is the back reaction of Hawking radiation, because Hawking particles not only carry away information from black holes, they actually also carry away mass and energy. And that must have an effect on the black hole itself. The black hole must lose mass and energy by emitting the particles.
Exactly what kind of mechanism that is not totally clear from the standard calculations. In fact, there's some confusion about this. Confusion that reach magnificent heights when people talk about the so-called firewall. The firewall, which is basically a negation, a denial of what general relativity is supposed to tell us. General relativity should tell us that if someone moves into a black hole, he or she would not see any of effect from the Hawking particles, let alone a firewall. So if that happens, there's something basically wrong in our understanding. And this always has been my main theme, there's something basically wrong in our understanding of Hawking radiation. There's nothing wrong with Hawking's derivation, by the way. It's a perfectly valid and sound argument, or so it seems. Right? If you just follow the book, the argument seems to be just fine. But now, if you ask further questions, you hit upon very mysterious problem. But now you've seen that I have added a second title to my talk at a later, when I was preparing this thing, which is on the renormalizability of quantum gravity, which sounds like something completely different and unrelated to black hole issues. But that is not so. I'm going to argue that renormalizability of quantum gravity, what does it mean, first of all, to have a renormalizable theory of quantum gravity? Is that what we want? It will be what many people ask. And at first sight, I would say, no, we don't want just renormalizability. We want understanding. We want to have exactly right all the equations of the theory. And if that requires renormalization on the way, so be it. So asking about gravity to be renormalized may not be the best possible question one can ask. I grant you all that, but I see that there is something interesting to be said about that topic. And that's why I want to briefly explain what one could say about renormalization of gravity. So I go back to the 1970s and earlier, when renormalization was a sort of magic word in quantum field theory, which theories are renormalizable and which are not. If you think of Young-Mills theory, is that renormalizable? Those were questions that are very much at our minds. So not very surprisingly, when the standard model started to mature in the later 70s, the next question that was asked was, what about gravity? Should we also not renormalize that? And very quickly, it was clear that gravity cannot so easily be renormalized because of things having the wrong dimension. The Newton constant has a dimensionality which is such that if you go to smaller distances, the forces seem to blow up in a way that cannot possibly be squared with the idea of having a renormalizable theory of gravity. But the theme I want to briefly touch upon is that the process by which the weak interactions became a renormalizable theory is actually very interesting. The discovery of the renormalizable models of the weak interactions, or the electroweak interactions, could have taken place along a different route than it actually was. So I'm going to give a non-historical explanation as to how we could have discovered renormalizable theory of the electroweak force, starting off with a completely non-renormalizable theory that we had. And this is just the table of contents of what I'm briefly going to do, which is that in the ordinary Fermi interaction, which all the theory started off with, the Fermi interaction saying that when two fermions meet each other at one point, two other fermions emerge. So altogether, four particles are involved. Two particles come in, two different particles come out. And that's a four-point interaction. And that interaction was fundamentally non-renormalizable. In that theory also, you would be able to introduce magnetic monopoles. Magnetic monopoles had been studied by Paul Dirac way back in the 1930s. And he already noticed that there's a quantization rule for magnetic monopoles. But the monopoles he studied were fundamentally singular. There was a singularity that you couldn't get rid of, a so-called Dirac string. Now, the claim is what could have been done, it wasn't done this way, but it could have been done this way, was you could have formulated the theory using auxiliary fields, and then look at the divergences, and then discover that there's something missing. When you discover something is missing, you cure the theory by adding the missing term to the Lagrangian, and lo and behold, you get a renormalizable theory. Not only that, but that renormalizable theory also contains pure magnetic charges, as the case may be. depending a little bit on further technical details that I won't go into. But those magnetic charges are again magnetic monopoles without any singularity. So now you get a theory that also contains monopoles without singularity. And the remarkable thing is that you can do the same thing for gravity, I claim. For gravity, we start with the Einstein-Hilbert action, and just like we had for the electric weak theory, we discover it's hopelessly non-renormalizable. So what do you do? And also there are black holes, and black holes contain a horizon and a singularity. Now you add auxiliary fields, you discover the theory is divergent, you notice there's something missing, correct the theory for the missing terms, and then you get and then you get something that looks like renormalizable. And then again you look at this crazy soliton-like object called the black hole, you discover it's no longer singular. It doesn't even have an horizon anymore, it has no singularity, it seems just as regular as the magnetic monopole. And if that is the case, then the information problem should also go away. I say should, because this is something one has to check in a real calculation, which is very, very difficult. Now, let me explain now the electric weak theory a little bit more detail. So what was it in before 1970? Before 1970, that we had this four Fermi interaction. The way the interaction was described was to say that you have a fermion, a current. The details of the count is not so important, but there were, it basically looked like this. And then you take the square of that count and you put that in your Lagrangian. And then you get a theory. And that theory is not renormalizable. So now what could have been done is, you see it here, two fermions come in, two fermions come out, and there's something happening here that you don't understand. That was the theory in those days. Then we could have said, well, let's introduce an auxiliary field, a vector field, which is an auxiliary field that comes associated with this vector current. But we rewrite the Lagrangian this way. We write A squared plus and then an expression which is only linear in the fermionic current. That has the promise of being a renormalizer theory, because now if this A has the correct dimension, then this thing has the correct dimension to be possibly renormalizable. This would bring us one step further towards a renormalizable theory, even though I did not change any of the mathematics. This Lagrangian is identical, has the same physics as this one. And that's because you can integrate out the A mu field, find that A mu is just G times J mu, and then when you plug it back in, you again get this Lagrangian. So nothing happened. You can recover this Lagrangian by just this auxiliary field. Physically, nothing happened. Mathematically, the whole thing looks different than what it was before. You could do the same thing to get the masses and other symmetry breaking features of the electroweak theory in their place. And that is by adding another scalar field. Mind you, this is not how it went historically. Sometimes people introduce scalar fields which do a job like this. They're called schizon, which is they break things without doing anything else physically. So a schizon field is introduced. Which you could give a self-interaction like this, which means that the field will have the value f in some direction, and then instead of a mu squared, you write a mu squared phi squared. And this was only in order to enhance the internal symmetry of the theory. So you wanted a local symmetry. Why do you want that? That is just a guess. This is actually the reason why historically things did not go this way. People couldn't have guessed that this was the right way to add more auxiliary fields in a theory. But this phi field could also explain all the fermionic masses which do not obey the local symmetry by just coupling those fermions again to the phi field. Well, this would have been good for nothing. If someone wanted to publish a paper with just this proposal, the paper would probably have been rejected because no new physics is revealed by this procedure. But mathematically, you could do something. You can ask for what is the divergence of the theory. Why is the theory not renormalizable? And the answer was, if you take closed loops of those fermions, by the way, the theory at this point only contained fermions as dynamical variables. So if the fermions go into a closed loop, diagrammatically, you get the first quantum corrections, you find all Feynman diagrams containing these fermion loops are highly divergent. And if I now only need to know the fermion loop with two of these auxiliary A fields, you find that divergence goes like k squared A squared. And also, the scalar field would have k squared times phi squared, and there could even be a diagram like this, two phi fields and an A field. So all these diagrams are basically fundamentally divergent. So the only thing you had then had to say, this, now it looks like a minor step, but would have been a gigantic step if people had actually done this historically this way. The step would be, well, if these terms are needed as counter terms, let's put them in the Lagrangian all from the beginning. So let's add a term which has this symmetry structure. It turns out to be the Young-Mills Lagrangian. Why? Well, the theory has an internal local symmetry, so no other term could have come out than F nu squared. These would give rise to kinetic terms for the phi field, which up to now was just an auxiliary stationary field you could integrate away. But now you give it a kinetic term, now you can't integrate it away anymore. But actually, this d mu is going to be a covariant d mu, so that means that you get also diagrams of this form, just because the field phi is not invariant under the local symmetry. So now you see all those terms, you're now familiar in the standard model, the Young-Mills terms, the kinetic terms for the Higgs field, and the way the Higgs couples to the fermions, all that now in agreement with the local symmetry. And now you discover, by God, this theory is renormalizable. Why is it renormalizable? Well, all the counter terms that you need for the theory are already there in the original Lagrangian. But you have to realize this, that actually terms go away when k goes to zero. So now you understand why, if you only know the long distance behavior of the theory, you only know the theory how it behaves when k is very small, now you can see why those terms did not sit in the original Fermi theory. Because we were working at too low energies. We didn't find the correct k dependence yet. So that's why those terms seem to disappear in the old Fermi theory, and now they're added as kinetic terms, and now you get the full standard model. This leads to the Young-Mills theory, of course, as I said, but actually to the entire standard model as well. This could have been the way we could have discovered the new renormalizer theory for the weak force. And now, my claim is, in principle, we can do the same thing for gravity and just see what happens. But again, you have to be very smart in guessing the right auxiliary fields, which at first will just be mathematical ingredients good for nothing. It looks like you had no good reason, no good physical reason to introduce those, but only mathematically it would make life easier. So the following attempt appears to be successful, and that is that take the Einstein-Hilbert action, add to it the meta Lagrangian, and leave space for another addition to be added later. I call L kinetic, the kinetic term today does not exist in our understanding of gravity. So this is going to be a new term, and the Einstein-Hilbert action is a usual action. I add to that the cosmological constant, not so much because it has actually been observed that there is a tiny cosmological constant, but because it's very illustrative for what I'm going to say next. To have such a term also, I put that in the Einstein-Hilbert action. Then we also add the meta fields, but now we know exactly how to do that. We now know the standard model, so yes, we can add the standard model into actions, but we don't put here yet anything. And now we find that this theory also has a black hole, and the black hole has a horizon and a singularity. Something is not quite right, but that's mainly because we all know something is not quite right in quantum gravity. It's not the renormalizer theory. We do not understand its small distance structure sufficiently well. And now come the auxiliary fields, and this is a guess. Maybe someone else will do it in a different way. I do it this way, that I first extract out a totally useless field. You could call it a dilaton field. My way of adding a dilaton in the theory is by writing it as a square of something, omega squared. Other theorists put here an exponential function. You can do it any way you like, depending on what you want to do next. For me, it's very important to write here an omega squared. Then Lagrangian depends on omega and g hat. Well, g hat is just whatever happens to the metric tensor if you pull out the factor. So altogether, this has a trivial local symmetry. That is, I can multiply g hat by a function capital omega squared, If I divide little omega with the capital omega the same way, of course the net effect of this transformation is completely nil, nothing, so it doesn't change any of the physics. But now I can also say my scalar fields, other fields have dimension, therefore they also scale with the factor omega. Then I have built in conformal symmetry in a theory. Again, if I would send this paper to a journal, they say, well, you've done nothing physically, so what is this good for? This is just only auxiliary fields. But it does add a new conformal symmetry to the theory. Omega actually defines sizes of things and scales of things. So the fields that we are familiar with in ordinary language are always the ratios of phi divided by omega, or psi divided by omega into the 3/2. Those are the fields that you normally use. Normally, we never use the phi field separately and the psi field separately. Okay, now is the proposal. Do this and see what happens. So this changes a little bit the definition of sizes of things. That if you take out the omega field as just another conformal field, then sizes are the coordinate sizes, but they don't mean a thing. It's like having a relativity theory where you say there's an absolute velocity. No, there's no velocity anymore, you can just transform. Same thing I have with size, an absolute size doesn't exist anymore because you can transform everything along by making a conformal transformation in your coordinate frame. So, but if you do this, one striking thing happens. You can rewrite now the Einstein-Hilbert term, the Lagrangian, and it becomes this. It becomes a beautiful kinetic term for the omega field. And that's why I wrote it as a square originally, because now you find that you get a ordinary looking kinetic term for the omega field. There is a term omega squared r hat, because you are using the g hat potential, which you also are familiar with when you take ordinary scalar fields, you also add a 1/12 r phi squared. You do that to make the theory behave in a canonical way on the conformal transformations. This actually physically has very little significance, this term here, because on shell, r vanishes anyway, so it doesn't change much of the properties of the theory. By the way, the cosmological constant here will carry a factor omega to the fourth. In a scalar field theory, you have a self-interaction also like phi to the fourth. It still will leave the theory renormalizable. So the one striking thing about this action is that you say, hey, this looks like a renormalizable theory. Omega, it just obeys a renormalized Lagrangian, somewhat unexpected, but this is the way it happens. And the other matter fields are renormalizable, so why is this theory not renormalizable? Well, because there's something missing. What is missing now is a kinetic term for the g-hat field. G-hat, the matter tensor with the conformal factor subtracted away from it, is still a dynamical field, but it has no dynamical term in the Lagrangian. That's why the theory doesn't make any sense, or rather, it does make sense because it's just a mathematical transformation of the theory that you're all familiar with. But there's something very odd about it. The kinetic term for the g-hat field is missing. In fact, what happened is, originally that was in the Einstein-Hilbert action, but the Einstein-Hilbert action, by this transformation, changed into a kinetic term for the omega field. If you look carefully, you find another difference between the omega field and the phi field. The phi field could be just a Higgs or any other scalar field in a standard model. The difference is the sign. The omega field comes with what looks like a wrong sign. It comes with plus signs here, whereas here you have minus signs. But this plus sign is crucial for the theory. It's not an anomaly, not a disease. Quite to the contrary, you just do the theory as if nothing happens, and you find this is the right way to handle things. It does mean that in quantum mechanics, you might choose omega to be an imaginary field rather than real, which is rather strange, but if you do the function integral, you find that indeed a correct prescription is to take a complex contour for the integration, the function integration over omega, not a real contour. Then the function integrals are completely nonsensical. You have to take a contour along the imaginary axis. But now, as for my program of constructing renormalizer theories, let's look at the divergent diagrams. And all the diagrams which are divergent are now diagrams which have g-hat as the external lines. So g-hat couples to the other fields, but g-hat did not have a kinetic term. So what you find is these diagrams where the heavy wavy lines are the G hat metric tensor lines. These diagrams all diverge typically as a fourth power of the momentum, k to the fourth. And I write here delta G hat. I mean, if you take a variation in G hat, then these carry powers of G hat affect any power. It's nonlinear theory. And they all come with a factor k to the fourth. So now you ask, I have a symmetry, a theory with an enhanced internal symmetry. That is what my omega field was good for. It adds to the theory local conformal invariants. So now all these counterterms, whatever they are, they must automatically be locally conformal invariant. Otherwise, the theory would be internally inconsistent. So the only local conformal invariant term that you can have is the Weyl curvature squared. You cannot have I mu nu squared, not I squared, or any other combination except for the Weyl combination, the C squared. And you know, you can transform these, yes?
There will be an R squared term that you can write, just R right R from the half. You use the phi to compensate to make it conform invariant. It will not be written entirely in terms of omega hat, but it will be conform invariant.
I don't say. But we have to discuss this later because I'm a bit puzzled by that remark. But because Mike was saying something more or less the same remark when I gave this talk earlier, that the strange thing is, if you do this just by the book, then you find indeed that there are other terms. But I claim that if I would follow the rules according to, well, the book about symmetries, then I should expect all these diagrams to display internal conformal symmetry. So
conformal symmetry, because you have a phi that can be used as a compensator, so you can always write anything in that conformal fashion.
Yes, except that I think I'm going to impose an extra condition on this series omega here, I squared it. And that means that this is now a completely renormalizable action for this omega field, which is conformal. So there is internally, the only interactions that G hat is having with this other field is conformal invariant interactions. So I'm just looking at conformal invariant in terms of the G hat field. And well, as far as I understand, there should only be this term coming out. But we should leave this for a discussion, perhaps, whether it's obvious or not. Because the other terms which, oh no, it's continuing on the next slide, that, so my claim is if the theory would be worked out right, we should only get these terms. However, there are anomalies, and maybe, but we discussed that, what you're talking about is a conformal anomaly. And the conformal anomalies are going to be a plague, but also interesting at the same time. So this is going to be a very important feature that we have to discuss in this theory. So this theory would become the fourth derivative of only the transverse components of G mu nu, and one can analyze what this interaction does. The expansion with respect to this coupling constant, which I put as a 1 over a coupling constant here, just like you often do in Young-Mills theory, then the kappa expansion is a more or less familiar perturbation expansion. So now I can consider this entirely as a perturbative theory where I've looked at all the perturbatively renormalizable terms you can have there. And now, we all also know what happens if you put fields in the ground which have k to the fourth in their propagator. Those fields are going to generate negative metric states. And this has been very much my concern. I'll postpone it for a moment, but this is related to the remark that Kelly just made, the 1 over omega squared. So if you do the thing that you talk about, and I had a discussion also with Michael here, you get d omega over omega terms and d omega over omega squared terms. If you look at the r squared and you plug in back what you call phi field, but I call that omega field basically, the dilaton field, you get 1 over omega terms in your interactions. And those terms, to my mind, should be forbidden if omega is an ordinary scalar field. So if we forbid this, we say we must have a constraint on the theory. These terms should not appear. If they do appear, it's a conformal anomaly. We must demand conformal anomalies to be absent. I want conformal symmetry to be an exact symmetry. This also was actually was led to this idea from studying black holes. Then I come back to black holes and say that indeed, we should have exactly conformal event theories, not approximately conformal event theories, not conformal event theories which have conformal anomalies in them, because then I'm in deep trouble. So this is basically the consequence of an anomaly that we should try to remove from the theory by brute force, perhaps. But that's also makes the theory interesting, by the way. If you're forced to change the model, the way you thought it was, in order to rescue a symmetry, then maybe you learn about new physics. So it's a non. This is where the whole theory becomes non-trivial, of course. And now, black holes. A decaying black hole has an information problem, and I tried to formulate this problem already before. That the problem is how to translate the behavior of black hole in terms of physics of the vacuum surrounding the horizon, and how to derive for a black hole a meaningful Schrödinger equation. All these problems are there. So, for instance, there's a problem of the following sort. And this is a problem which I call the complementarity principle. I'll say why it's a principle, but first phrase it as a problem. The problem is if you have two observers looking at a decaying black hole. One observer goes into a black hole, will go right through the horizon, as if nothing happened at the horizon. So that observer will definitely see that he is surrounded by the metric of a space-time, which is the metric of a Schwarzschild solution with a mass m, the same mass that he fell into. But the distant observer who sees that the black hole decays will also see that incoming observer hovering around on the horizon, never getting through, but shrinking slowly while the black hole shrinks while emitting Hawking radiation. So eventually, the outside observer sees that the black hole is losing all its mass while the ingoing one is still going in. So, well, how important this problem is somewhat something, again, you can discuss. But I claim this is an important disagreement that two observers have about the mass of the black hole. And this I would like to resolve in terms of a principle called black hole complementarity. The idea is that both observers are right. They observe what they observe, and they deduce from that what will happen next with a black hole, but they're using different language. It's very much like in relativity theory, where the concept of electromagnetic fields change roles when you describe how a moving observer looks at electric and magnetic fields. It's something very similar, that different observers look at sizes differently now, and what they really differ about is mostly the conformal factor. So the point I want to, the difficulty arises when two observers disagree about the vacuum state. So one observer will say, no, it's going to be the Hartle-Hawking state, that's going to be my vacuum, and that's the ingoing observer who will claim that. But the observer says outside, says, no, no, that's not the vacuum state at all, that's a state which is full of Hawking particles. My vacuum state is what's called the Bohler vacuum state, and that is when I try to remove all the Hawking particles. I'll never succeed in doing that all the way, but that would be my vacuum state if I could remove these Hawking particles. Who is right here? And of course, it all depends on what your killing vector, your time vector is going to be. And so, in a way, they're both right, but they have a different definition of the vacuum state. And since they have a different definition of vacuum state, they have a different definition of vacuum expectation values of fields. So that is why the two observers will now disagree about the conformal factor. And roughly speaking, when you have a firewall, what will happen is that if two observers look at an atom the other side of the firewall, one observer will think that the atom shrinks, and the other says, no, no, that doesn't shrink. I just had to perform a scale transformation to see the atom at the same size as ordinary atoms. So who is right about this? Well, it's a question of choosing your coordinates right. So the theory is going to be complicated by the feature that you don't know absolute definition of sizes anymore. And that's what's the whole idea about conformal invariants. So for instance, what you can do is you can take the mass of a black hole. Yeah, I want to speed up a little bit. I see my time's running short. So the mass of the black hole could be made time dependent. In this way, I take the Schwarzschild metric with the mass removed. I put the mass as a term in front. This is a way you can rewrite the Schwarzschild metric, by the way. But now, the different observers have a different idea about the conformal factor in front. So one will say this m squared is a constant. The other says, no, it's a weakly time dependent. Since it is weakly time dependent, this is no longer a solution of the ordinary Einstein equations in vacuum. No, there are particles, and those are the Hawking particles, which either remove, get out of the black hole, or other observers will actually see Hawking particles going into the black hole. So again, other observers will say, no, those are the Hawking particles. That's a collapsing star you're looking at. That's going into the black hole. So they all disagree about what goes in and what goes out. And by that, they disagree about this factor m in front. Because without factor m, you see nothing going in. With factor m constant, you see nothing going in or out of the black hole. If m is time dependent, whatever way, you either see things going in or you see things coming out. So so this would be a way to get that issue straightened. And roughly what you see now is that with conformal symmetry active, you can describe the black hole. This would be the more or less conventional picture of black hole. It arises, it may emit Hawking particles, but it never reduce its size. That's wrong, of course. Hawking particles carry away energy and mass, so it should reduce in size. What picture is right? Well, my claim is this is what the outside observer would make out of it. The outside observer says, no, here a black hole is formed. The collapsing matter never really goes through the black hole. At least I don't see it going through the black hole. Eventually, collapsing matter will reach a point, but that's when the whole black hole has disappeared by Hawking radiation. So now you see that the Hawking radiating black hole looks more time reversal symmetric than the classical black hole. You also see in this picture, in a sense, the horizon disappeared. If you look more carefully, also the singularity at the center also disappeared. It has been removed to the infinite future long after the black hole actually decayed. So the singularity really isn't there anymore. And the Penrose diagram then also starts to look like an ordinary Penrose diagram of the vacuum without any topologically non-trivial distortions. If you have a Penrose diagram like this, then the ingoing information and outgoing information will be related by ordinary S-matrix elements. So this should remove the information paradox. I say should because I haven't actually done the calculation. So, but this suggests that all these ingoing particles, the early particles and the late particles all together form one single entangled quantum state. And in discussions about the firewall, this was an important theme. To what extent are these particles entangled with these particles? The answer is yes, they are entangled because all together they form one single state in Hilbert space. And if your Penrose diagram is totally trivial, nothing disappears anymore, so there's no reason to think that this will be a density matrix or anything, because you've got the entire Hilbert space at your disposal to construct this state, which is not the vacuum state, because you did have a time non-invariant situation as a background. The background time is not the time that a local observer would use here, and therefore this state, which is a vacuum state for the local observer, is not the vacuum state for the late observer. That argument still holds. So you do see Hawking particles coming out, but you do see them coming out entangled in a single quantum state. Again, this is a formal answer and not yet a technical answer. The way you can look at conformal symmetry is also this. I think it's very interesting that actually the outside observer could see a black hole as something shrinking, but the whatever is making up the matter which forms a black hole is not ordinary matter at all. It's dynamite. It contains explosive material, and all that explosive material explodes exactly at the right moment. The distant observer will not actually see the explosion. He'll see it very, very strongly redshifted. So strongly that the only thing you see coming out of the explosion is Hawking particles. So here are the Hawking particles that the outside observer sees coming out. The local observer will then say, no, this is an explosion. But someone who goes with this stuff into the black hole will disagree, because he says, I cannot possibly imagine who set the fuse here so precisely that explosion took place exactly at the right moment. And actually, in the ground observer, not see any explosion at all, but see the thing continue to a singularity. So now you say, well, this is a conformal transformation. From the picture where this matter continues to form singularity to the picture where the matter actually explodes to make outgoing particles, that is just a conformal transformation. A space-time transformation, which affects the composition of matter as well as space and time, so it's a very complicated transformation which you have to work out. By the way, this requires baryon number violation, because if these are baryons, there's no way to make them all explode. The standard model contains baryon number violation in a very subtle way, but so it's not impossible, but now you have to say how that all that can be used here to make this thing hang together properly. So now you see that features of the standard model, of which the origin was somewhat obscure, now become very, very essential. We cannot have conservation laws that would prevent this explosion to take place. So you see, you are going to have very strong demands on the composition of the matter part of the Lagrangian. It's not free in this theory. So it now looks as if the black hole became regular, and that is, again, what this theory has in common with the electroweak theory, where you now suddenly, with all the normalized Lagrangians, you can make a magnetic monopole that is locally regular. The non-conserving forces. I want to save time a little bit, so I just say a few words what this says. The standard model cannot be chosen to be anything you like. The matter Lagrangian must be very, very special. It must be such that if you perform these transformations, you get a theory which is entirely conformal invariant. That is not automatically the case. A theory which is like the standard model, if you remove all the masses, you don't get a conformal invariant theory, because the theory will be full of anomalies. In fact, all the Cullen-Simoncic beta functions express different conformal anomalies in the theories. All these beta functions in the new formalism should vanish, which means that all the parameters in the standard model should be at their fixed points, which also means everything should be calculable in the standard model. And this is one exciting thing about this theory. It makes the standard model such that everything should, in principle, be calculable. Now, I left for the last the problem of the negative metric, because there was a wrong sign in the omega field, but worse even, I had a k to the fourth propagator. And that sign is a sign in all the quantum field theory that cannot be right. If you have a 1 over k to the fourth, you can actually disentangle that having two poles. It's 1 over k to the fourth in your propagator is obtained if you take the difference between two poles, a 1 over k squared pole and a 1 over k squared plus m squared pole. So I investigated this wild curvature squared action to find out that action actually describes particles of two kinds. One is the ordinary graviton, it's still there, 1 over k squared potential. It has correct metrics, so the graviton is a physically acceptable particle. But besides that, it has this funny pole. And then I investigated that funny pole, 1 over k squared plus m squared pole with the wrong sign, and looked at its helicity of the fields associated with it. I found helicity plus or minus 2, helicity plus or minus 1, and a single field with helicity 0. And then I investigated the poles, they're all on the same pole, m squared. And then I said, of course it is. This is a heavy, a massive spin 2 particle. It's a massive companion of the graviton, which I decided to call gravitello, just because gravitino means something else. So it's related to a graviton, so I call it gravitello, as a partner of the graviton, which is a heavy spin 2 particle, which therefore has 5 components. But altogether, this makes the theory apparently work, except for this awkward minus sign. The minus sign means that the particles produce either negative probabilities or it contributes negatively to the total energy. These two views, two interpretations of the minus sign are interchangeable. You can say either it's an object with negative energy or it's an object with negative probability. If you look carefully, you find that this is basically the same thing that you're saying in somewhat different words. Now, the claim is that this might have a natural explanation in the theory of quantum gravity. Natural explanation is that Einstein's equations are obtained by saying that G mu is related to T mu matter, but G mu is also actually the energy momentum tensor of the omega field. That's the Einstein tensor T mu. So when you say G mu equals T mu, you say T mu of matter minus T mu of the omega field is zero. The minus sign comes because omega field has the wrong sign, remember? So that has a negative energy momentum tensor. The Einstein equation has basically 10 components, out of which 4 are just natural consequences of coordinate reparametrization invariants. So basically 6 independent equations. And now I say, look here, the T mu of matter was originally related to the G mu of Einstein, but the G mu is a G mu of a single field, only 1 degree of freedom. I need 5 more degrees of freedom to add up to this 6 component situation here. So I think the Gravitello also has the wrong sign because it has to look at the right-hand side of Einstein's equation, not the left-hand side. So the left-hand side is something which obeys a conservation law, just like the right-hand side does. And so so if you interpret the Gravitello as part of the gravitational field, its wrong sign is as acceptable as the wrong sign is for this omega field. Now, this is somewhat mysterious, and I'm not sure this is the right interpretation, so this could be, again, something for discussion, whether this is sufficient to say. Normally speaking, when you have a negative metric, your theory is in a very bad shape. So whether it can be cured this way at all is something that has to remain to be seen. Just a few words. You may have heard about the so-called asymptotic safety theory of gravity, which is a theory that the gravitation forms a non-trivial fixed point in the ultraviolet, so that you get an effective theory for gravity where you have an ultraviolet fixed point. The theory I've been proposing is not that different. Here also you have internally a sort of conformal invariance near this point here. So this is a conformal invariant theory, somewhat related to the theory I've been proposing. I claim that the Gravitello with its wrong metric might be the same disease which could also emerge here in the form of Grebov. Of Landau ghosts. The Landau ghost is an apparent unphysical excitation that theory can have when you have an ultraviolet fixed point. So you have to be very careful whether these theories are internally consistent or not. I think I have the same problems as these theories which use asymptotic safety. The difference is, in the case of asymptotic safety, you take this point far away from the perturbative domain. Whereas my theory, the way I phrase it, if I have one more adjustable parameter, which is this wire coupling squared parameter, I can take that in the perturbative domain. Then everything can be handled in perturbation theory and just see what happens. Everything should be calculable, but the price will be that, that you have to make considerable modifications in the standard model, because otherwise the calculations give you conflicting results. So preliminary investigation of the standard model led nowhere. I couldn't make the model work such that in the new formulas or its beta functions cancel, and that it becomes a meaningful theory. That is still too much to ask for. But you do get a prediction that such theories may be constructible in not so distant future. A theory where all parameters which are normally freely adjustable parameters in a standard model, all these freely adjustable parameters are calculable. And that's one of the main messages of this theory, that we shouldn't give up hope of being able to compute literally everything in a future theory of everything. And those are my conclusions. The indefinite metric problem can be addressed. The question is, whether what I said so far is a good starting point to understand negative metric problems with this theory. I think it might be something we have to investigate further. So this is more or less a little over my scheduled time, but I also saw this will be empty. Plenty of time for discussions, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
So what do we do now? I just saw that there was a discussion on the program, but... So let everybody shout and find me. Well, I haven't made those studies as extensively as I wanted to, because I was involved with other projects as well. So, in principle, of course, the whole Lagrange itself has a classical limit. The anomalies have to cancel, and in the classical limit they might not. That's not totally obvious, but in principle there is a conformal invariant theory, and it means that scales of things are not what you think they are, and that's you always have to keep that in mind when you consider the theory. So my proposal is to put the negative metric gravitello field, which is the cause of the problems that you mentioned, that because it's negative metric, it's unstable. But I put it at the other side of the equation. I say, no, I have the energy momentum tensor of matter that generates a gravitational field, which you get by solving such and such a differential equation, and then that tells you that there's a gravitational field. The 1/k⁴ in the propagator suggests that gravity will be screened at very small distances, so much so that that it never comes too strong at the Planck scale, and that would be its internal reason for being renormalizable, that gravity will very rapidly shrink at very small distances. That's what this theory would suggest.
Gerard.
Yes, Kelly. Yes.
That actually removes it from the spectrum, so its apparent wrong sign is of no consequence. But it's been too massive field, however. It's really there, and you can't gauge it away. So moving it to the right-hand side is just chucking the cars. You're not going to get rid of the problem.
I
can make
this
one...
This would have been my first reaction, too.
Yeah.
So you're quite right. But then, when you think a bit longer, you said maybe there's a way out along these lines. But I haven't figured out all the details. But I sympathize very much with what you say.
There are two things I could say about that. One is that the asymptotic safety idea is one that has been pursued, in particular by Niedermeyer, who's written a Living Reviews long article with Reuter. The idea there is to use the renormalizable R plus R squared plus phi squared theory and the asymptotic freedom of the two quadratic curvature terms. Such that although the negative metric states are in principle present within the Hilbert space, the coupling to those states can go to zero at large momentum so that you never wake them up, basically. That's essentially the idea. The question in any asymptotic safety discussion is, does it really happen, right? There's violent arguments back and forth about scheme dependence and so forth, and for that you need another whole conference.
Okay. The other thing I can say to my defense, I understand what you say, is that in conformal symmetry, familiar notions such as energy and time and distance all disappear. So you have to realize that a low conformal transformation is quite a big departure from the situation where you can have intuitive ideas about stability, about positivity and of things and so on. All these go down the drain quite a bit. So you have to think twice before you say this can't be right because of the negative metric and so on. So I said, okay, normally speaking, I would say exactly the things that you said. I agree with that. But this is not an ordinary theory. This involves space and time itself. You have to gauge some form to get the right coordinates. And then you have to realize that the coordinates I use are not representing ordinary distances and time scales correctly, and mass and energy don't mean anything. Now you have to think again, what do you really mean when you talk about stability of solution? That then becomes the nasty question. And I don't have a ready answer to it, but I only say that maybe the answer is more complicated than just a straight rejection, as one would be inclined to do. And until only a few months ago, I would have exactly the same answer, saying, no, this doesn't make any sense because of the wrong sign, schluss. But maybe the answer is not that simple.
I can add one other thing, which is classical, and it may be a rather dangerous point of view, but I understand from Toby Weissman that the classic proof of stability of flat space in general relativity extended to general relativity plus a scalar field still works, even if you flip the sign of the scalar field so that you make it a ghost. That the largely dispersive nature of gravity causes flat space still to be stable within perturbation theory. It's still, if you consider non-perturbative solutions, it's a bad theory. So it's possible that the spin two modes here behave in the same way. Whether you want to trust yourself to live in a theory that's only perturbatively stable, I think I leave to a philosophy conference.
Okay. Anyway, I won't be claiming that I have the correct theory of gravity before having answered such questions. And I can't answer your questions today. So that must be noted, that there's still lots of work to be done. And maybe this is a false alley, like so many other alleys. You'll find out about it soon enough.
I just add also about the conformal anomalies. If you really insist that all conformal anomalies cancel, then I don't have any objection to your having only the vial squared term as the counter term. But you do have to take into account that gravity has its own conformal anomalies because of the Gauss-Bonnet invariant. Mm-hmm. So you have to make sure that that coefficient, as well as everything else in the standard model, all the other conformal anomalies cancel out. So this rather tight constraint.
Yes, it's very tight. But so probably the bottom line is that we have to find a better formalism to build this in so that these things happen automatically and not by brute force. It's going to be a tremendous amount of work, and you fail in the end because you forgot something. And so yes, but the thing I was very much intrigued about was if I look at the standard model with this omega field added and the other field added, and I then demand it has to be on a fixed point in this randomization group, that's a very interesting demand. It's not totally silly, and it's not hopeless that maybe a model will be found that happens to sit at that fixed point with interesting values of its couplings, which are all calculable now by the demand that you have to be at that fixed point. So that makes it, to my mind, an exciting possibility, which it still remains to be seen whether it makes any sense or not.
The particle that you called it something like a gravitino, it has a mass term in it. And does it also interact with other forms of matter, you know, where it has more degrees of freedom because of the spins? And I was wondering if it affects the classical, could affect the classical limit of gravitation.
I didn't quite understand the question.
Well, you know, there's the paradox where if you have a massive graviton, that you have this effect on the Mercury orbit and the path of light because of the extra degree.
I have a massive graviton, but I also have the original graviton still doing all the usual work.
Okay.
The massive graviton has a mass which could be anywhere between a TeV and the Planck scale. So, you know, it could be a wild range of possibilities, which does not affect the motion of planets or classical general relativity experiment. Of course, I would insist that general relativity as you know it today still makes sense in the large scale domain of the universe. Only at very tiny scales, something has to go. And of course, the black holes we are most worried about are the microscopic black holes. And the divergences we are worried about are divergences at the Planck scale. Yes. So there we want to cure the theory, but I don't want to modify the theory at very large scales.
I see, thank you.
It generates Yukawa terms. It generates Yukawa terms, so depending on the scale of the mass, you either worry about those or you don't.
So in my case, the Yukawa terms will kill gravity at distance scales much shorter. It would make it 1 of k^4 instead of 1 of k². So that means the gravitational force will dwindle beyond that scale. And it has been tested somewhere until a millimeter or so, or a few microns. There, this apparently doesn't happen, but who knows what happens beyond that.
I'll talk about some of these things in my talk.
So, thank you for a very interesting talk. Could you say something about the scales that are involved there? Like, where does this correction become important? And you said something about the early, late, and very late phases. What, you know, with respect to what?
Okay. It's a question I'm afraid I cannot answer, except saying that these are very tiny scales. So tiny means it could be anywhere from the standard model to all the way to Planck scale. Of course, the standard model, I even don't know that for sure, because gravity is such a weak force that if it is sufficiently different already at the standard model scale, we wouldn't know that today at all. So where to start modifying things, I don't know. Of course, you have to be also a little bit careful phrasing things correctly, because in a conformal invariant theory, there is no scale. All scales are equivalent. The only thing that matters is the ratio between things. So the ratio between this dilaton field and the Higgs field, for instance, that ratio is what we normally call the Higgs field, and that remains the same. So the physics of that part of the standard model should be the same physics that's being studied at the LHC today and from the standard model. So, but now you have to talk about scale ratios and not absolute scales, because this is the way where we formulate the model, where we use any coordinate frame we like, and we renormalize the theory no matter in which conformal gauge we're looking at. So that's so there, scales don't make any sense anymore. Conformal, the theory is supposed to be exactly conformal invariant, so exactly scale invariant, but only in a trivial way. So the scale invariance comes back in via the back door, so to speak, when you say, no, what we consider scale today, the size of an atom, for instance, is the ratio, the size of the atom, as compared to the strength of the omega field at that point.
Okay, so the corrections could become relevant in principle long before you reach the Planckian curvature regime. Is that what you're saying?
Nobody knows. This theory is not good enough to say at which scales these things happen. It could be anywhere close to the Planck scale, then we won't know about it for a very long time. It would be more interesting if it happened at the millimeter scale, then precision experiments in gravity would already reveal something. But that is perhaps wishful thinking. I wouldn't put too much money on if I change gravity at the millimeter scale, but it could in principle be.
Gerard, as I recall, the conformal anomaly terms, the terms that contribute to the anomaly coefficients, tend to enter in with the same sign for both the Weyl squared and the Euler-Gauss-Bernet. Even in super Yang-Mills, n equals 4, I believe, there's still a non-zero anomaly. Do we know of any theory which has a exactly zero anomaly, conformal anomaly?
I don't know. I think if there is such a theory, it should be constructed by methods totally different from what we're used to now to build that in. But as you say, some anomalies have very obnoxious constant signs. I thought there was something about the gravitino. I don't know.
Yeah, well, pure Weyl squared supergravity has a vanishing conformal anomaly if it's coupled to a matter sector with a dimension 4 gauge group.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a funny constraint, which it doesn't fit the standard model, but.
Professor Stella knows the answer much better. So yes, I have to thank you for the remark. So there is a way to construct such theories, but yes. I think, personally think, that's not the theory we really want, because it has too much symmetry, right? The super Yang-Mills supergravity theories, to my taste, have too much symmetry to be good candidates for the real world. But maybe I'm wrong there, and maybe one can turn those theories into useful theories in this respect.
We'll then have to work to break that symmetry spontaneously to reach our,
yes,
our world.
So we have to find our way between Scylla and Charybdis, because they're both, they're problems. If you go too much that way, you have a problem, because much that way, you have a problem. So to find how to make such a theory will be a big question, yes.
I'd like to go back to the question of classical or semi-classical phenomenology a little bit more. It's well known that in Einstein's theory, if we write down an equation for gravity waves in an expanding universe, that equation is not conformally invariant. In fact, it looks in transverse tracery gauge like a massless minimally coupled scalar field. And that fact's used, for example, in trying to predict the gravity wave modes that we might expect to see in inflationary models. If gravity is exactly conformally invariant, would you expect to see deviations on cosmological scales?
Well, the words I've been using might have been a bit confusing, because I'm not claiming a big modification of physics at the scales that we are familiar with. So the ordinary Einsteinian gravity should still hold exactly. I don't want to touch that. So, and that includes many of the cosmological considerations one has in making cosmological models, that is still a domain of physics where I would not expect a major modification of gravity. But when you talk about scale in that case, you talk about, again, the relative scales, the phi field divided by the field I called little omega. So those ratios are now the things that you normally call scales. I have no constraint on that. But I have constraint on what if you disentangle those fields, then if one of these fields goes to zero, nothing should happen. And that's a big deviation from what we normally think. But that always means it's an information about the infinitely small distance limit of nature. So this dilaton field that I introduced, and I claim there was no 1 over omega term, means that if this omega field goes to zero, nothing happens. What it really means is if you go to distance scales much shorter than the Planck scale, you will see nothing happening. And that is a piece of physics that we have very bad intuitions about. We don't understand that very well. So this is why the remark is somewhat unusual. But it should not affect physics at very mundane scales that we're used to. You can still continue doing cosmology the way you're used to.
The one that we actually measure and observe today from it.
Yes, the cosmological constant, I'm not sure I understood the question correctly, but the cosmological constant is one of those parameters which should be completely calculable. And the thing that I miss out completely and I don't understand is the hierarchy problem. What is it that makes the cosmological constant as small as it is today? And that question has not been answered by my theory, unfortunately. I wish I had, but I have to confess, no, I do not have a good answer as to why this number is so tremendously small. This is a big mystery today. But the remarkable thing about the theory is, small or big or whatever, it's calculable. It should be a number you can work out with some fancy mathematical problem. And you'll find the first 122 decimal places to be zero. And why that is so, there should be an answer to that, but I don't have it.
There's no indication about why that.
No, So the striking thing is it's calculable, but the other thing is we don't understand why it is so small. And that's because there are too many details of this theory, which is totally, totally mysterious.
But one might say that one would expect it to be of order one.
Of course.
I mean, if there's no...
As has been remarked by umpteen people, right, if you just plug in the numbers, you expect the cosmological constant to be equal to one. That's completely wrong, isn't it, for many reasons that they can't be right. So nature chose another way, and I'm sure there'll be people doing physics as long as we don't have the answer to the question why this is so. We want to have the answer to that question. Yeah.
I'm trying to understand the second half of the talk, and so I have several related questions. First, did I understand correctly that the split of the standard Einstein tensor into omega times g caret is something that is somewhat arbitrary. So there's something like a gauge transformation in a generalized sense. And you said that observers outside the black hole should use a different one from observers falling in. Okay. So the first question is, why is that so? Why shouldn't any observer be free to use any frame or any gauge?
Well, the way anybody would set up, say, a theory of gravitation and other forces is by defining the fields as compared to the value it has in the vacuum. So you say that the vacuum excitation value of that field is 1, and then you do your perturbations. Unfortunately, the different observers of black holes disagree about the vacuum state.
That's so, my second question.
So then, if you disagree about the vacuum state, when one says my omega field is a field that is 1 or 1 over g in vacuum, and this is the field I use, the other says, no, I'm going to use a different omega field because I want my field to be exactly that value, but in my vacuum, not in yours. So they disagree about which number to take. And that disagreement will linger on in the other disagreements that they have. So one observer sees that if you throw a pebble into a black hole, it will shrink in size because the black hole slowly shrinks in size as well. The other observer says, no, I go with the pebble, I don't see it shrink at all. So they disagree about sizes. And because they do that, they disagree about everything else as well.
So that's what I'm trying to understand. I know what a Bohr vacuum is for a scalar field or an electromagnetic field. And when you say the Bohr vacuum, are you talking about a Bohr vacuum for the omega field or for some of
for all the fields? All the fields. I mean, as you know, all the particle species that you can make up in your standard model, they all be radiated away by the black hole. Mm-hmm. So they all contribute to whatever vacuum you have, whether it's the Hartle-Hawking vacuum or the Bohr vacuum. All these particles contribute, so you have to take them all together. But maybe I haven't understood the question sufficiently.
Well, it seems to, I've always thought that the big contribution that Bill Unruh made was to understand that what was interesting about the Rindler quantization was not the Rindler vacuum, which would be the Bohr vacuum in a black hole theory, but the Minkowski vacuum or Hartle-Hawking vacuum looked at from a Rindler point of view.
Yes.
And so if you are in an accelerated state of motion, you perceive a thermal radiation. But there's still a unified physical picture of what's going on. It's not, the two pictures are not really in contradiction, and the physical state is either a Hartle-Hawking type vacuum or an Unruh type vacuum, depending upon initial conditions.
Okay.
So why do we even need to talk about Bohr vacuum?
The situation is simple and transparent as long as you don't take the back reaction into account. Mm-hmm. So the fact that all these Hawking particles actually do carry the gravitational fields, whether you like it or not, because they are particles, they are the source of gravitational fields. Mm-hmm. In the standard description of Rindler space and, of course, the black hole horizon, you don't take that into account properly, or you're very much tempted to leave it out. But leaving it out is actually a big mistake, but primarily so because Hawking radiation has basically an infinite spectrum. If you do it naively, you just follow the rules and you forget about that reaction, you find that the Hawking spectrum, in fact, the Bohr vacuum cannot exist because it's an infinite departure from the state that you know of in Hilbert space because it diverges at the horizon. So this divergence means that Hawking particles would carry away an infinite amount of energy and mass and thereby generate an unlimited gravitational field. Something is completely wrong if you do that. So it's obvious that you have to somehow handle the back reaction more carefully. That's why this meeting was very important. This is about the back reaction of Hawking particles. We have to understand the back reaction. And it's there where you discover that if one observer sees particles which carry enormous amount of gravity with them, so that space-time behind those particles looks totally different for that observer, but the infrared observer doesn't see those Hawking particles, so they disagree. They don't disagree about the matter tensor so much at our side of the horizon, but they disagree what it is at the other side. If you go beyond that curtain of Hawking particles, what is the matter tensor there? And now they both disagree because one says, no, you have to take those particles into account. They are the source of gravitational fields. So the matter will obey Einstein's equations. It will be different behind than it was before. But the other observer says, no, Hawking particles are just mathematical artifacts of you sitting in the wrong frame. I'm sitting in the right frame, I see no Hawking particles, so I don't also see no change in the metric tensor. So now you see where the clash comes, and the clash is not just general relativity and coordinate transformation and such. The clash is, in a more basic question, what does the metric tensor mean? What does it stand for? And how come the different observers must see a different number there? That's not just a general coordinate transformation, it's something more. And that's what I'm interested in.
But a covariantly renormalized stress tensor, expectation value of the stress tensor in a particular field, particular state, is absolutely defined. It doesn't depend upon what Fock space language you're using. Now, I agree, I do not know how to take account of Backreaction in detail. But
if you do that, people have tried to do that and usually find that the energy momentum tensor, the vector station value is very small to or zero for Hawking particles. But you also know that can't be right, because Hawking particles eventually can carry away all the mass and energy of the black hole. So they must,
where you're looking.
They must carry lots of energy and momentum eventually. So that number cannot be as small as some people claim it is. They claim it's small because, of course, you have these particles that go into the black hole, which balance out in a sense, so that it looks very small. But you also know far away from the black hole, the particles did come out, eventually carry away all the mass. So you can't have it that cheaply. So there's something that needs to be further explained and worked out in a proper theory. How do we take into account this back reaction of the matter?
Apparently, you can feel free to have coffee over there and continue to discuss.
What about food?
Fruit.
Yeah, everything is asked.
Okay.
Gerard?
Who's asking?
Me, Carla. Hi. I have a very naive question, which it's probably related to what Stefan was saying just now. I realized there's something I got confused about. At the very beginning, you sort of build the theory in two steps. First, you just replace G with two fields, omega and G hat. And then you said, G hat knows about the conformal structure, the light cone structure, which of course is obvious, and omega knows about the scale. I would say, at least at this stage, that omega does not know about the scale. It's only the product of omega times G hat that knows about the scale, because of the previous interpretation, and because what we do in GR is not to just define the scale, but read out the scale from the behavior of matter, how it couples to the gravitational field. So I guess the question is what I said right or not, and does it change when you actually modify the theory by changing the Lagrangian? So are you giving to omega a physical interpretation related to scale, which only appears at the second point, or is just you're making an hypothesis that omega knows about the scale just by itself and not together with G hat, as I would suspect at the first step?
All this is very much a question of gauge fixing, because now we have added a new local gauge symmetry called conformal symmetry, if you will, which has to be fixed somehow by choosing your gauge. And when I looked at this for the first time, I really thought of gauge fixing by just making a gauge fixing on G hat. Say, for instance, the determinant of G hat is 1. That's a nice way to fix the gauge. Once you say that, then all the rest is done by the omega field. And then omega fixes the scale. So that remark was a remnant of that insight. But now I no longer am so much interested in fixing the gauge by saying that the determinant of G hat has to be 1. The gauge fixing can be done at any later stage, any way you like. It doesn't really matter much how you fix the gauge.
Right, but then, so if your gauge fixed G hat, the term of G hat equal 1, for instance, then of course the scale is coded into omega. But if you don't, it's not.
Right. So basically, you have a theory where the coordinates mean even less than they did before. So the coordinates themselves are no longer a signal about what the scales are. But you need those coordinates, for instance, to renormalize the theory. So you have to go to very small distances and then make a subtraction. But if you make that subtraction, the subtraction better be free of anomalies. So there should not be a beta function associated with that, because then you're in trouble. So and this is now the main ingredient of this theory.
Thanks.
So sorry, but I have confused myself about the equivalence of the two observers, the one that sits away from the black hole and the other one that falls in. So in which sense are they really equivalent? Because, I mean, we know that they do have access to massive fields that are not conformally invariant. So, like, couldn't they use the mass term to figure out which metric is the right metric? Because in the other metric, the mass term is coordinate dependent?
No, the only thing that you have to our disposal to measure, say, is the size of atoms, for instance, and the lifetime of particles and so on. So there are time scales and size scales that you can use. But now the atom has to be looked at with respect to this omega field. So the only thing that we measure when we do normal physics, ordinary physics, is the size of an atom compared to the size of the omega field. Now, in ordinary physics, we would normalize omega just to be 1 or 1 over Newton's constant or something like that. It's a fixed number. And then you don't need that anymore to define the size of an atom. So for ordinary physics, you have to compare the atom with the size of that. Now, there's another thing which I wanted to ask to Carlo when you asked this question, that was about the size of things being absolute and being used by an observer to define things. The problem is that still true when you have a very, very dense background of matter? So suppose that you're inside the neutron star state, deep inside the neutron star, where you have a tremendous high pressure of matter. Can you still define the size of an atom there? I claim it's not so obvious, because there's so much matter there that the atom, first of all, doesn't exist at all anymore, and so you don't even know what its size would be. Or what is the velocity of light inside the neutron star? Even there you can ask questions, because there's so much matter there which affects any photon that you can think of, that maybe the speed of light is no longer well defined. There are questions of this sort, but for the speed of light, I still think you can get away with it, to say the speed of light is still well defined inside the neutron star. But maybe the size of an atom is not, or maybe there are some margins that you can vary, depending on who's looking. An atom inside the neutron star lives so long or so short, and so on. So there is some question there whether the usual components of the metric tensor are as well defined as you usually take them to be if you have a very, very dense medium of matter where everything is different from what you thought.
So you're saying basically that this difference between the two metrics that appears in the Lagrangian does not actually appear in any observables that you could conceivably measure? See, the thing is that if I would look at this Lagrangian, when I have the scalar field with the position-dependent mass term, I would say, well, that's the wrong metric. Okay, but you're saying that this is not a, it's not a physical thing. I could not measure it.
No, the mass term is now multiplied by omega squared.
Yeah.
Which means the mass term, the original mass term that was sitting there prominently in the stellar model as the mass, or rather negative mass squared for the Higgs field, is no longer a term m squared phi squared, but it's m squared phi squared omega squared. So it changed into a conformally invariant coupling between four particles, two phis and two omegas. So it's as conformally invariant as all the other interaction terms of the theory. So so all parameters of the standard model become dimensionless in this theory, because wherever you have dimension, you put their factor omega to any desired power in your theory. And this is one of the things about the renormalization, where you want logarithms. So you want the logarithm of omega, and then I say, no, the log of omega is not allowed, because that's singular and omega goes to zero. I don't accept such singularities in the theory. So then you get quite a bit of subtleties there.
So, at least naively, the theory that you used had a massless spin 2 particle and a massive spin 2 particle.
Say it again.
The theory that you used?
Okay, hold it closer.
The action you wrote down finally, including the wild curvature squared piece, had a massless spin 2 and a massive spin 2 particle. And the massive spin 2 was a ghost, basically.
Yes.
Yeah, so. Okay, but then you had conformal invariants and all that. But there's a different way of doing things, which is approaching it completely from a different point of view, where you write down the action for a massless spin 2 particle interacting with a massive spin 2 particle. Okay? And in that case, you can actually have a Lagrangian where both the massive and the massless spin 2 particles are non-ghost particles.
Yeah, I skipped quite a few details in this talk. So, for instance, this mass, you might be worried about this mass or the thing I called gravitello field. Yeah. Where does that mass come from in a conformal invariant theory?
Yeah.
And the answer is, that's when I already took the Einstein-Hilbert term, which is the kinetic term for the omega field. I gave omega now a vacuum excitation value. If what you do in normal theories, it would be correct to put that number simply to 1 and remove the omega field altogether, I get back into ordinary physics. But the wild square term is still there. But now masses are well defined. I have to fix my scale by putting omega equal to 1. Now masses are understandable what they mean. And in that frame, this gravitello gets the mass it gets, which could be a number between the Planck mass and the inverse or a microelectron volt, anything like that.
Yes. So I understand your point of view. I was just making a comment that there's another possibility to write down a theory of a massless and a massive spin 2 particles, and there is a theory where you actually have different ground state solutions depending on a kind of moduli parameter. Okay? You have a region where the theory actually becomes conformal gravity with a massless spin 2, a massive spin 2, and conformal invariants, okay? Where the spin 2 particle actually is a ghost. But there's another region of parameters, another region of the moduli space where the massive particle is not a ghost. It's actually a healthy particle, and the conformal symmetry of the conformal invariant changes to what is called partial massless symmetry in the other sector.
What I phrased so far is what happens if this omega field has a vacuum excitation value, and that's where ordinary gravity originates from the fact that the omega has a very large value, which is 1 over Newton's constant. However, as we are familiar with symmetry, the spontaneous symmetry breakdown, you can look at the symmetric mode of the theory. We can do this in electroweak theory also. In electroweak theory, you can look at what would the theory have done if the Higgs field had no vacuum excitation value at all. And the answer is all the fermions would be massless, they would be degenerate, and there would be a young male's interaction among them. Those fields would also be massless. Basically, all particles would become massless. The answer in this case is very similar. The wild square term would be a single field with a 1 over k to the 4th propagator. There would be no k square plus m squared propagator anywhere because mass is not well defined in the symmetric mode. So the symmetric theory would have everything massless and everything running around with the appropriate propagators, which are fixed powers of k squared. But I don't know whether that answers the question.
That if you replace conformal symmetry by what is called partial massless symmetry, which appears in massive spin 2 field, massive spin 2 field, then you have a possibility of having a complete linear scale of a massless and a massive spin 2 field. So I would make a general comment that
the massless theory would still be unitary, at least in, and I'm not talking about ordinary gauge theories, where the situation is more transparent. So say the electroweak theory where you can flip the sign of the mass term for the Higgs so that there's no effective expectation value, then everything is massless. Formally, we still have unitarity. We certainly have unitarity perturbatively in the perturbation expansion. You have to be a bit careful because the states in Hilbert space are a bit difficult to define now because all these massless particles are running around, causing a tremendous mess everywhere. So it's not so easy, but in principle, you can do perturbation expansion and see that order by order, unitarity is obeyed. I don't think that's obviously going to be true in this case because I have a 1 over k fourth propagator, which is not by itself unitary. So there will be a big problem with unitarity if you go through the symmetric phase all at once. I gave a suggestion that maybe we have to put things at the right-hand side and the left-hand side of the equation differently just because of this nasty conformal symmetry that makes it impossible for us to define properly what energy and mass is. So because of that, we have to make some different switch. That was just perhaps not yet properly worked out, so it was just an attempt to see maybe you have to argue this way. Bernard, has a question.
So you suggested during your talk that if you submitted a paper with this omega theory and it might well not get published. So what do you think would take to have something that was physically calculable from the things you've described today so that we could say, well, this doesn't measure up or this doesn't?
Well, I think the second half of the talk contains things where I deviate from standard physics. So one of the big deviations is what happens when this omega field is introduced, when it goes to zero, at 0 points. I claim nothing should happen because in the Higgs case, also nothing happens when the Higgs field goes to zero. But that's a big deviation from standard physics. So now I can say, well, maybe you still react by paper for other reasons, but now I'm proposing something physically non-trivial. So then I think, at least whether it's right or wrong, is something one can discuss. But I'm proposing a physical change, a change in our view of what's happening physically.
But even so,
what predictions that eventually will give, nobody knows. But I made one prediction, which is everything is calculable. Next question will be calculated, and I've not succeeded in doing that. That's much too difficult. But in principle, now the prediction is that the thing now called the standard model with its 26 over 26 freely adjustable parameters, they will no longer be freely adjustable. They'll have fixed values. If they hadn't had these values, the theory would be wrong.
Does that mean there must be some other fundamental constant other than things like the speed of light and the gravitational constant that
no,
fixes
no, just algebra. I think the constant will come by postulating the algebra of the standard model of particles and gravity interacting with them and so on and so forth. All this is algebra. So you give me the algebra, I calculate everything else.
As one more follow-up to these questions, I mean, your example of electroweak theory is very nice, but we know the scale there was set by the Fermi constant, and the scale at which the new physics comes in is therefore set by that. So I think this was asked already, but I wasn't clear on the answer. Are you suggesting this conformal symmetry, the new theory, will come in at the Planck scale as the Newtonian constant sets the scale just like the Fermi scale, or are you suggesting a different scale?
No. Well, you could ask a similar question for the electroweak theory. You could ask, is the electroweak theory locally gauge invariant at the Fermi scale or at what scales? And of course, the only correct answer is it's locally gauge invariant on any scale. So conformal invariance happens at all scales. The fact is, of course, we don't recognize it today in ordinary physics. Everything has definite size. And that is because this field I called little omega is a dominant and important field. Its value determines everything. And so the sizes of atoms and sizes of people and sizes of planets all compare to this omega field. If I vary the omega field, the people look smaller or larger. But in ordinary physics, it's irrelevant. You just say, well, this is a dummy, nonsensical field. I put it equal to 1, and then everything's fine again, and then you have a definite scale. But it becomes particularly relevant at the Planck scale.
At the Planck
scale. Where we want to understand microscopic black holes, but also we want to understand these divergences of gravity. and we want to understand where the standard model comes from. All these questions have not been answered today, and so we are searching for answers there. And we all believe that the answers are somewhere near the Planck domain. How near is, again, a question of discussion. Some people think the Planck domain could be just across the LHC. Then that would be marvelous if true, but I don't believe it. But anyway, the questions become completely irrelevant at the Planck scale. Just like in the electroweak theory, the question of local symmetry became relevant at the Fermi scale.
I agree, but a question, I guess, that we'll discuss much of the rest of the week is how something at the Planck scale, new physics, could help us with large black holes, which are kilometers.
I don't believe it helps us much for large black holes. Oh. I think large black holes don't need quantum mechanics for their existence and understanding their physics. But for large black holes, in principle, you know, large black holes emit Hawking particles, but the emission is so tremendously weak that nobody can ever see it. It will be much, much weaker than the cosmic background radiation that they are submerged to anyway. So it will be completely negligible in all reasonableness. So for that reason, cosmological black, say the black hole, the center of the galaxy, or black holes that arise from collapsing stars, for all those, the Hawking radiation is highly irrelevant. It's there in a formal sense. It's mathematically there, but something important.
So in that regime, do you expect we can use semi-classical gravity?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. An announcement first. Laura, all your tickets to tonight's public lecture. And let's give Gerard a round of applause.